Again is the assassination of Malcolm X and Dr. Martin Luther King. And Dr. Baldwin, before we had our second commercial break, we promised that we would give you an opportunity sort of give us some additional information about the assassination of Dr. King. Of course, Dr. Al-Hadid will sort of feed in off that.
Yeah, I wanted to pick up on a point that Dr. Al-Hadid made about the possibility of the two men coming together. There are two reports about what happened in the weeks prior to Malcolm's assassination. Dr. Kenneth Clark, the black psychiatrist, and also William Consler, who was a civil rights attorney, both men reported that Malcolm and Martin had scheduled a meeting for February 23rd, 1965. And of course, they were to meet in Dr. Clark's office at City College there, perhaps discuss the future course of the movement, because Dr. King at that time was interested in moving from the North to the South into places like Chicago and perhaps even Harlem. To deal with slum conditions and education and other problems that were confronting the inner cities. As Dr. Al-Hadid pointed out, Malcolm was assassinated on February 21st, 1965, 2 days before that scheduled meeting. And one wonders what would have happened had they had the chance to really meet and talk and to sort of map strategy for the future. I think that too had some influence on the assassination, certainly of Malcolm X. Because the meeting was planned about 2 weeks in advance of the assassination. And of course, there was no way that the power elite could allow these two forces to come together in the struggle. I mentioned also before the break that about these two schools of thought on King's assassination. Now, in the early years, 1970, William Bradford Huey published a book called He Slew the Dreamer, and he advanced this lone assassin theory about James Earl Ray being the only assassin. And that theory has lasted up until now. Gerald Posner, a couple of years ago, published a book called Killing the Dream, where he advanced that same theory. But I think the prominent theory today is the conspiracy theory. Most of the scholars who deal with the assassination of Dr. King line up with that theory, arguing that that King's assassination resulted from a combination of forces from the intelligence community, organized crime, local police officials, and I tend to subscribe to that theory myself.
You know, Dr. Al-Hadid, Dr. Baldwin has indicated the violence associated with both these assassinations, but I think you also indicated during the break that this was also a period of the bloody 60s in which not only are we dealing with the assassination of King and Malcolm, but we also are dealing with others. Speak to that issue.
Yes, it was the decade of the assassination of Medgar Evers, Robert Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, and there were a lot of things going on abroad, too, in terms of assassination of leaders or overthrows of governments. King made a statement. He said that the bombs dropped in Vietnam explode in America in inflation and depression and economic injustice. And he also said that he'd come so far that he could not, at this point, segregate his morals, that justice is indivisible, that violence in Vietnam is morally wrong, and violence in America is also morally wrong. So I think that both men were moving toward an international interpretation and understanding of the problem. In 64, Malcolm made the pilgrimage in April. And that same year, in December, Dr. King received the Nobel Peace Prize. So both of them were anointed as international statespersons. So when they came back into America, they had the power of that. King became a threat to the intelligence community at the point in which he received the Nobel Peace Prize, because they knew at that point that whatever he said was basically the word, and people would respond to it. Another thing you have to understand, too, is that King, too, was shifting from race to class. His last movement was the Poor People's March on Washington, and in the interim period, he was working with the sanitation workers, which was a class issue. Even though there were black men involved, it was fundamentally a class issue. Organized labor was involved in that, unions were involved in that, and Malcolm was also dealing with economic issues. he was approaching it from a Pan-African standpoint. Mm-hmm. He was approaching it from an anti-colonial or anti-imperialist standpoint. Mm-hmm. Dr. King's anti-imperialist position was against the war in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Malcolm's anti-imperialist position was against what America was doing in the Congo, mm-hmm. what America was doing in Ghana, what mm-hmm. America was doing mm-hmm. with Egypt. Mm-hmm. So he was able to pull together allies in Africa, allies in the Muslim world, and if he had been able to get allies in the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. then that case that he was trying to take to the world court in the United Nations would have been very effective because mm-hmm. he would have had the full momentum of the African-American freedom mm-hmm. movement inside America, mm-hmm. plus the freedom movement in Africa, mm-hmm. Asia, and in the Muslim world. Mm-hmm. And at that time, you know, a lot of the African countries were becoming independent. They were becoming members of the United Nations mm-hmm. and had a voice in the United mm-hmm. Nations. You also will remember that King met with Johnson, and Johnson advised him to go and talk with Ralph Bunche and mm-hmm. Chief Goldberg yeah. in the United mm-hmm. Nations. Mm-hmm. Bunche tried to discourage him mm-hmm. from coming out against the war in mm-hmm. Vietnam. Of course, he was inside the United Nations mm-hmm. working mm-hmm. on behalf of the United States. So it was a very exciting time mm-hmm. to have lived through that period, to have been of age during that period of time. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think that we learned a lot. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, with the forces of reaction coming down, and once Nixon came into power mm-hmm. and the conservative element started mm-hmm. and all this massive campaign to eliminate the movement, then I think we started regressing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And when the 70s came in, things was just unraveling, mm-hmm. coming apart at that time, because you didn't have mm-hmm. these leaders. One other point I want to make real quick, and that is, J. Edgar Hoover, who had started out being against Marcus Garvey, mm-hmm. then he developed this theory that he wanted to stop the rise of a messiah. Mm-hmm. And so getting rid of Malcolm, getting rid of Martin Luther King was based on this mystical mm-hmm. idea that he had of stopping the rise mm-hmm. of a messiah. Mm-hmm. And that's really what his obsession was mm-hmm. with Malcolm, mm-hmm. Martin, and Garvey.
Mm-hmm. And all of these individuals represented to him
the possibility of a Moses mm-hmm. rising up in modern mm-hmm. day Egypt. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Baldwin, over the last few minutes, let's have you to say something in reference not only to these two assassinations, but in reference to where we can go from here to make our people much more sensitive in terms of what these individuals were able to accomplish and what they did for the movement entirely. Mm-hmm.
I think in a sense with the assassination of King and Malcolm, the movement sort of turned the corner. Mm-hmm. Dr. Ali Deed made a comment that I think is important, because after the assassination of King, conservative political forces moved into power mm-hmm. and tried in many cases to turn back the clock. Mm-hmm. I think what we have to make sure of today, and we've had to pay attention to this since the assassinations, mm-hmm. is that the death of these men the deaths of these men don't mean what? The death mm-hmm. of their ideals mm-hmm. or the death of the struggle. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm afraid of, because the movement changed with the assassination mm-hmm. of Dr. King. Today, if you look in the black community, neoconservative forces have mm-hmm. emerged. Mm-hmm. And you don't find the kinds of prophetic voices that existed with Malcolm X and King in the mm-hmm. 1960s. Mm-hmm. We need to recapture that spirit mm-hmm. of prophetic religion, mm-hmm. Of social activism mm-hmm. That existed during that period, because we don't have it. Mm-hmm. We've become a part of the political processes mm-hmm. in this country. Many of our major leaders are involved in those processes, mm-hmm. some running for president. Mm-hmm. And I think that sort of stifles mm-hmm. What could be strong prophetic voices, mm-hmm. because Dr. King and Malcolm X operated outside of the system.
Good. Mm-hmm.
Because they felt that once they became a part of the system, mm-hmm. they couldn't be as prophetic mm-hmm. as they would be outside of the mm-hmm. system. So I think we need to recapture that spirit of prophetic religion that they brought to us, mm-hmm. That sense of the need to be involved mm-hmm. in struggle, mm-hmm. That culture of resistance, as one scholar calls it.
And of course, I would imagine that both of you, during this last half minute that we have here, both of you would encourage individuals to become involved and the celebration of Dr. King's holiday, the birthday of Dr. King, and all of those other activities, just for the whole sake of not only remembering what has happened, yeah. but also, as the two of you, I think, have indicated, for laying the foundation yeah. so that we might be able to move forward. And of course, let me thank you, Dr. Alladine and Dr. Baldwin, for yes. another excellent show, because
thank
I
you.
Think that in simply voicing information in reference to these two great leaders will sort of bring them together and make us have a better understanding of some of the things that they attempted to accomplish.
Yes.
And of course, let me encourage our audience to tune in again next week for another informative edition of Cummings. Thank you and good morning.